Accurate diverse stories in the media are critically important. SRC Partners is a full-service cultural production firm. From development to market, we provide expertise on diversity and inclusivity. You will reach a much wider audience when they feel heard.
Hello, hello. Welcome to the Non-Obvious Beyond Diversity Summit. I'm your host, Monika Samtani, and the founder of Ms. Media and the Fem Word. I'm a producer of Be the Future, an award-winning documentary short, and just recently, the co-producer of Priya's Mask, India's first female animated superhero. It's my honor today to be talking with two esteemed, bold producers, bringing the diverse faces of America to our screens. The panel is women of color, top producers flipping the script. And thanks to our organizers, Nonobvious and SRC Partners. Now, before we begin, I'd like to read something very important to us. It's a land acknowledgement message. And I want to take a moment and reflect upon the history of the indigenous lands we call home. While we are meeting today on a virtual platform, all of us occupy spaces that carry the powerful legacy of these diverse peoples and their unique local cultures. Through this acknowledgement, we reaffirm a deep commitment to improving our understanding of America's shared heritage and recognize our collective responsibility to improve the bonds between all nations. We're grateful for the opportunity to meet you wherever you may be on your journey and toward a more diverse and inclusive society so that we can do the work together. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our discussion today. Women of color, top producers flipping the script. Joining us are two major creators. It's my pleasure to introduce Deniese Davis, co-founder of ColorCreative, co-executive producer Insecure, about women navigating and shaping their life in LA. Hi, Deniese, how are you?
Hi, Monika, I'm well. Thank you for having me.
Of course, thank you. And Meera Menon, director of Ms. Marvel, bringing Marvel Studios' first Muslim hero to the screen. Welcome, Meera.
Hi, Monika, nice to see you.
Thank you both so much for being here. You both have such a diverse repertoire of work, and you intersect when it comes to changing the landscape of Hollywood so that minorities are seen and heard. What I really love, though, is your unique story and journey of how you got here. So Meera, your father's a filmmaker, but wanted you to think of it as a hobby. And Deniese, you wanted to be part of stories through moving pictures that can help change the world since a really young age. So as we dive in and start talking about your personal experiences, one really big question that I have is about the idea of tipping points, especially as women of color. So what made you stop and say, things need to change and I want to do this? Dive right in. Because I'm sure there's a lot you have to say about that.
I mean, it's a great kickoff question. I don't know, Meera, do you want to go first? I'll speak to the first thing that comes to mind, because I often have to think about, like, when did that start, right? When did that passion and the realization of or the acknowledgement of the lack of diversity in our industry? And I think for me, it wasn't in film school. It was actually the result of coming out of film school and entering the real world of the industry. And what I realized is, you know, I call myself a film school baby. I went to undergrad for 4 years, and then I went to grad school for another 2 years immediately after. So within the 6 years of context between New York and LA, you know, I was so focused on learning the skill sets of producing and entertainment that it wasn't until I was getting out that I really realized I was coming out of places that I was the only one in, right? And then not recognizing that also was honestly the makeup of our industry as well. And by chance, meeting Issa immediately after grad school helped kind of reframe that narrative. And I remember the first time I watched Awkward Black Girl in preparation for meeting her, it completely just clicked where I was like, that's the content that I want to do. And I hadn't realized that it wasn't the content I had been doing in film school. And that was mostly because I was surrounded by, you know, homogeny of white directors and white writers and you know, telling their stories and not really reflective of myself. And I had to, you know, do a little bit of soul searching because of that. It was that moment that I was like, how have I not been doing this whole time in film school? I even point to my thesis film, and you know, I am embarrassed to say there wasn't very many people of color even in my thesis film. So my rude awakening really was at the intersection of graduating from film school, from graduate school, and meeting Issa and seeing the content that she was doing independently for herself at the time. That just, I don't know, from that moment forward, I don't think I've ever looked back.
What amazing timing for you meeting Issa and the trajectory of your career since then.
It's been wild. We both we both joked that we grew up in this industry together. Just the other day, you know, I was 24, she was 27 when we met, and she was coming off of the heels of the first season of her hit web series. And so, you know, it's been about 8.5 years now of that journey together, and it really, really is incredible to think about all that we've done and where we started. And you know, I do think we'll speak about this later. It speaks to the way we see the world in this industry and the things we do. And it's mostly because we came up independently and you know, untraditional than I think a lot of other creators and producers in town do.
And with you, Meera, I mean, with your dad being a filmmaker and you really being surrounded by that throughout your childhood and your youth, but then he basically said, this is just a hobby. But then you go to school and you're like, oh no, it's not. Tell us a little bit about that experience. Yeah. And what changed for you.
So my dad, I mean, he wasn't a filmmaker by trade. It was more of a kind of hobby for him. He was an engineer for Verizon for 30 plus years. But when he came to this country from India in the 70s, he saw there was nowhere to watch films from Kerala, where he's from in southern India. And so started organizing screenings in like high school auditoriums and stuff, and just kind of realized that there was a tremendous hunger and appetite for this immigrant community in America to watch films from the homeland, and kind of created a bit of a side hustle for himself throughout his life and his career, just kind of creating community around filmmaking and film culture, Southern Indian film culture in America. And so, you know, actors and musicians and dancers and all these, you know, kind of incredible artists from South India would come stay at our house, you know, growing up. And I just grew up around artists. And I think I always knew I wanted to be creative, but I didn't know necessarily what that meant. I think when I was younger, I thought that I wanted to be an actor because that was the most accessible thing. That seemed like the way into it. And I remember in college going, like, there was, you know, just so little, like, kind of vision for what that could mean for a brown girl, that, like, there was this one open casting call for Matt and Ben, which was Mindy Kaling's off-Broadway show that was going on at the time, that she wrote this brilliant play about how Matt Damon and Ben Affleck wrote the script for Good Will Hunting, because it was a script that fell from the heavens, and that was like the premise of that play. And when she and the, you know, original cast left that show, there was an open casting call for like any brown girl in New York to go audition for it. And I auditioned for it. I remember it like, but that was like the one opportunity I saw out there for a brown girl at that moment. And then when I was a sophomore or junior, at some point in undergrad, because I, like Deniese, also went to undergrad and then went to grad school for film. But in undergrad, around my sophomore or junior year, I took a filmmaking class where I learned Final Cut Pro and I learned how to edit. And that was my light bulb moment. That was the moment where I was like, oh, this is actually the part of it that I understand. This is like my in. This is like my canvas. And from that point on, I was hooked just to the process of filmmaking. I was like, this is what I want to do. I don't want to be in front of the camera. I want to be behind it. And that's what gave me the permission also. Once I started to understand the process of filmmaking, it kind of unfolded for me, like all these potential ideas of how I could make a living doing it. But that, of course, took another decade or so to really figure out.
Yeah.
But learning the process is what gave me the permission, because certainly my dad, like any kind of immigrant dad, was like, you should probably be pre-med. And I was like,
well, that's what my dad said to me until I got a D in biology. In college. He's like, okay, no.
Yeah, exactly. I was never equipped either.
No. And in fact, you know, my background is as a news anchor and reporter here in Washington, D.C. And
oh, amazing.
My parents, you know, yes, my dad was like, you will be a doctor. I'm the eldest of three, until that couldn't happen anymore. But what's interesting for me is I started in the early 90s, and there were no brown faces at all for me to look at and use as an example or help me open doors. And so it's taken this long. I mean, yes, there are brown faces now, and I love that. And I love that it's open doors, you know, for obviously black and brown faces. But at the time in the early 90s, I think I was the only South Asian on major market television in Washington, and it was really difficult. And I'm just so happy to see the progress because yes, there is, we need, there's a lot more work to be done, but we're getting there.
Agreed.
Yeah. Deniese, your work includes fantastic work that you just mentioned, like Insecure, Black Lady Sketch Show, Burning Sands. Let's see a little clip of Insecure.
Let's have fun tonight.
Melanin, melanin made a facsimile.
I just want to be confident. Brave me.
Isa, what's on fleek?
I don't know what that means. I know what that means.
You can't commit to anything. Did you just send a text message?
I did not send a text.
Okay.
Love it.
It's so.
Talk about this storyline. I mean, first of all, it wasn't easy. It took a while to get this basically where it is today. And that's just the way Hollywood works.
Yes.
Talk about, you know, the storyline and the strong women characters.
Yeah. I mean, I think, look, what's so interesting about the history of the show that people, you know, tend to recognize is what I think speaks to the authenticity and the female friendships line is, you know, previously before Issa sold this pitch to HBO, she had already been in development on another show in the broadcast space. And, you know, as we both know, the broadcast season has a structure and there's, you know, you develop in the fall and then there's pilot season. And the project she had worked on, which was her first experience in television, writing for television, did not move to pilot. And so, you know, she was, of course, crushed, as we both were. And a few months later, HBO called and said, do you have something else? And so in this case, because it's HBO, which was her dream, she had really thought long and hard about, well, what's a different type of story I wanted to tell? Because I do think her experience coming out of the broadcast space really lent itself because she realized, like, in those spaces, you're developing content not speaking to your true voice most of the time, right? You are really defining a project that can fit a network's brand, whereas HBO is a place where it really is creator-driven and artist-driven and telling the stories that you want to say that are meaningful, important, and have a prestige to it. And so I say that because when she goes into to come up with the concept, it really, really came from a personal place. It came from her life. It came from, you know, she has this great core of best friends in her life that she's been friends with since high school to this day. And the inspiration came out of that, which is what I personally think is the reason why the show is so successful and speaks to so many different levels of humanity and relatable themes that you can connect to no matter who you are. And that is really because it comes from such a personal, dear place. And so the female friendships, because it's rooted in real life, honestly. And at its core, we also realized, like, you had never really seen a show like this. You know, Girlfriends was probably the only thing between that and Living Single, really, which were both sitcoms that you could point to in the history of Black television that had any level of similarities. But I don't think we had ever seen stories about female friendships told in a single cam level of long form narrative, right? And so it's one of those things that just right time, right place, and you know, shout out to HBO for fully backing and believing in the story that Issa wanted to tell. And I give them the full credit because they, every step along the way, they were so supportive and kept pushing to make it more real and, you know, kind of step back and let her tell the story she wanted to tell. And I do think that speaks to hopefully the trend that we're moving in this industry and in Hollywood, because I think that in order to tell the most authentic stories, you know, you do have to give a little bit of leeway to the creators and the artists and the people of color who kind of know these stories best.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, through your company, Color Creative, now under the umbrella of Issa Rae's Hooray, you're discovering and supporting emerging minority and women writers.
Yes.
Talk about that experience for us. And Is there a unifying theme when you're looking at these stories and that authenticity that you're talking about?
Absolutely. Look, we started Color Creative 6 years ago, and it's not lost on me that, you know, let's talk about the D word, diversity, right? 6 years ago, we took this idea and this concept of this company out to support these emerging, artists of color who we knew had a very strong voice and vision and lots of inspiration for stories. And, you know, meeting with folks around town, everyone was basically like, that's very cute, and didn't really see the importance at that time. And this is before even the Oscar So White campaign. So you have to really think about the timing where, you know, we initially came up with this when there wasn't a lot of programs and thoughtfulness put in place to really lean hard into building pipelines for marginalized people who had these stories that weren't being told on mainstream television. And so we decided after several tries to get partnerships and funding that we were just going to do it ourselves. And so that's what we did. And it was born out of us finding and identifying three amazing young writers who had amazing pilot scripts. And ISIS self-funded those scripts. And we shot them in the summer of 2014 and premiered them at Urban World Film Festival. And out of that, Color Creative was born. And so over the years, it evolved, and we did more partnerships with other partners to continue to build pipelines. We started doing events, and for us, it's been all about building community for these creators, and more importantly, building those pipelines so that way they are getting more opportunities and more access. And in the sense of, I guess in the previous, it's, you know, this industry is so fickle and hard to break into already, right? So it was really about how do you build a platform where you can build exposure through our relationships and our network. And so that's what we did. And over the years, the management company announcement this in 2020 was such a proud moment for Issa and I, because we had been kind of pushing this baby uphill for so many years. And we had actually wanted to do this 3 or 4 years ago. We were like, you know what? Someone actually came to us and said, you guys are doing the work as managers by identifying these these creators and supporting their careers and getting them representation, getting them their first jobs. Like, how are you not just managing them and backing them for the long term? And Issa and I were like, you're right. Like, we as young women who were just doing the work, you don't really sit back sometimes and think about the business model. You don't really think about, you know, the actions that you're doing and how to make that sustainable. And so the minute we heard that, we jumped into it. But we also, this is right before we shot season one of Insecure, we were like, who's going to give us two young Black girls like money to start a management company? That'll never happen. But we never lost sight of that. And so we, you know, ultimately ended up again betting on ourselves. And the end of 2019, we took a little bit of money. We hired a first manager, and we were like, we're just going to do it. And so in the last year, to see that expand and grow, I'm just so, so excited. And I really do hope it helps kind of set a foundation in this industry of just, you know, if you don't see it, you can build it at the end of the day.
Oh, yeah. I mean, so let's show everyone a little bit of Color Creative and how you're helping women dream big.
Now she hate me, cliche, cheapskate, love the deep fake. Said she never had a daddy, I ain't used to be impatient. Got a lot of spite, but that fight, I'ma wait. I can hold a lot of money, she can hold a lot of grudges. I buy a lot of weed and lazy, feel like I don't give a. I think I'm too young for love, must be love, too young for love. Must be drugs, too young for love. Must be love, too young for love. Must be drugs.
Is anyone else dancing behind me?
It's a great trailer.
Wow, I'm just amazing. I'm just blown away. Congratulations on that, Deniese.
Thank you.
And now, I mean, Meera, what can I say? I mean, your work includes Ms. Marvel, but also Farrah Goes Bang, Glow, The Magicians, Outlander, Equity, the list goes on and on. you know, in my research about you, I saw that you talked about the obstacles and the perceptions that women face as a female director. Talk about the choices that you've made in terms of your work and that story arc in your slate of projects.
I think what Deniese and Issa have done and what they've been doing is like exactly the model that, I didn't have growing up. And like, I remember when Awkward Black Girl was this web series and like already, like it was becoming such a model for other women of color, content creators that just weren't being let inside the gates, like to just start making your stuff and see kind of where that leads, see where the kind of just following your voice can take you. And for me, I mean, like, it was somewhat of a similar start in that, like, after film school, I didn't even know where to begin in terms of giving myself the opportunity when there didn't seem to be an obvious path to getting someone else to open that door for me. And so, you know, I made my first film with friends from, you know, college, undergrad, and then film school. And we, you know, raised the money on Kickstarter and, you know, it was a real micro budget kind of lo-fi effort. But that film was about three girls campaigning for John Kerry going door to door in 2004. And it was a road movie that was really a story about female friendship, similar, I mean, like kind of to the point of like kind of what I think inspires, you know, women. I mean, what I think Insecure has been doing so brilliantly for its run in terms of representing female friendship. We were really making a portrait of a group of young, diverse women trying to find themselves on the road, both politically and kind of spiritually. But it was a real lo-fi effort. I mean, I went to film school, but I really learned how to make a movie by making a movie. And that film, you know, like, premiered at Tribeca, won all these awards, played at like 30 different festivals, but it didn't get distribution. It didn't launch me necessarily into having my next directing opportunity. But we were really trying to make the movie that we wanted to see. You know, that was really the mandate there. It wasn't necessarily a career move, me trying to make that movie. I was just trying to find a way to express that thing, like that thing of not really feeling represented in any of the movies or kind of TV shows I'd seen growing up, and just trying to start making the content that I wanted to really see myself in. I feel like that was really what started it for me was, I mean, at least got my foot in the door in terms of like just getting my name out there. But it wasn't until I made, you know, the second film, Equity, which was this female-driven Wall Street movie, which again was about, yeah, flipping the script in a similar way. You know, Wall Street movies are so male-driven. There's so much about kind of male machismo. We were really interested in kind of finding a female perspective into that world. That movie, you know, just had a little bit more money, a little bit more stuff around it. And I was able to then start working in television because of that movie, really. And ever since then, it's really been about a series of choices that are about, yeah, finding stories about, you know, kind of people, finding ways to kind of tell stories about, you know, hero, you know, kind of the way I always think about it is just find new faces for the hero's journey, you know, like, and that continues to this day with Ms. Marvel. Just, you know, I don't know if there are so many different stories in the world to tell. I think there are just new ways to tell it. And for me, it's really about finding different faces and different ways to broaden our idea of what greatness looks like, what a hero looks like.
I think you brought up a couple of really interesting points, because people watching are in the entertainment industry, women and girls watching this right now, but also not in the entertainment industry. But what you said that's so inspiring to me is two things, actually. Learn by doing, just go out and do it and create that content that you want to see. If you want representation, make it happen. And I think those are two really important points as we venture out and try to figure our lives out and make things happen.
Yeah, because, you know, I mean, especially now, I mean, I always think about what if the first movie I'd made came out now 8 years later. I do think because of like adventures like ColorCreative, and so there's starting to be so many pipelines into the system in a way that there wasn't even, you know, in 2013 when that first movie came out. But at the end of the day, you know, like I think there's still, people want diversity, but they don't necessarily know what that looks like without, you know, without a sample of what that means. That's, you know, Ms. Marvel's a perfect example. I mean, that comic book came out in 2014 and it was a tremendous success. I mean, I don't know if anyone predicted that. I haven't talked to anyone there about like whether or not they could have like put a formula to how successful that was gonna be for them. But now they're making, you know, a big MCU project out of it. And I think that is that's the thing. They need to kind of see it to believe it. They need to see that it's gonna work in order to invest in it. There's still, you know, it's a fear-based business in so many ways. It's a risk-averse business in so many ways. And so to put, you know, and like what Issa did with Awkward Black Girl and like kind of entering the system into that in that way, like I think it's so important for women and people of color and people that exist in the margins to really just like tell their story in any way they can, in the scrappiest way they can, to prove to people that, you know, that it works, you know, because they don't necessarily have the vision to know it until they see it.
And look at your two faces that we just saw. Amazing. Yeah. Directors of this, Ms. Marvel. In fact, let's take a quick look at Ms. Marvel.
Ms. Marvel is a new kind of superhero. But at the core of all of it, her story is so universal.
Ms. Marvel is one of the newer characters in the Marvel comics. And when one comes in that grabs the world's imagination like this, the questions are, when are we going to bring Ms. Marvel to the screen?
When Ms. Marvel first came out, we had such an incredible reaction.
It was so incredibly popular because everybody could see themselves in her.
I never saw a young teenager of color, specifically a Pakistani, in a comic book. Are you kidding?
You promised you'd be cool.
I am cool.
The casting process was vast. When we discovered Iman, we knew that she was Kamala Khan.
It was unanimous decision.
Yeah, I can't comprehend this right now.
And then, of course, we've got a really incredible team of directors, Bilal Fallah, Adel Al-Arabi, Meera Menon, and Sharmeen Obaid-Chinoy. And all of them are taking the material and elevating it.
So human, it's about a teenager figuring out who she is and about relationships. Family and friendship is at the heart of the MCU canon. That's what's so exciting about the story that we're bringing is that we're going to introduce you to a new family that's also going to be part of the wider MCU.
Just so exciting. There's a lot of boundary breaking with a South Asian woman as a leading major superhero franchise. What does that kind of representation mean to you, Meera?
I mean, everything. It's the reason, like I say, you know, kind of the reason I got into this was just like not seeing myself or seeing opportunities for, you know, my sense of self represented in Hollywood and in Western media. And I think, yeah, just the fact that this is getting made is extraordinary to me every day.
The star character is a Muslim American teenager from New Jersey. I just produced a low budget PSA and comic book called Power of Priya, featuring India's first female animated superhero during COVID. And that feeling that girls could see themselves in Priya has just been unbelievable.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's so important. It's so important to have not just like relatable character, you know, see like just the relatability of our, you know, stories on screen, but also to have these aspirational figures that look like us on screen, to think, you know, they're to have these, again, yeah, heroes, these superheroes, to have these kind of untouchable, kind of incredible, kind of, like these again, heroes to aspire towards.
Yeah, it's really exciting and we can't wait for it to come out. Just can't wait. With both of you, in fact, Deniese, you sort of mentioned this with HBO and taking on Insecure. Streaming has certainly brought in more diverse voices. So let me pick your brain a little bit. What recent productions have shifted your perspective or have inspired you in the sense that, you know, what are you watching right now that makes you say, okay, there's the authentic reflection of the BIPOC experience, obviously, besides Insecure. Thoughts?
Well, I'll speak to what I'm currently, well, I just finished actually last night and talk about just eye-opening, but Lupin on Netflix, which is obviously a French-made show. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, but it's just, I'm almost speechless trying to describe it because It's French, and we actually took off the dubbing and just watched it in subtitles, just because I can't do it that way. But it has a black male lead. It's a, you know, this incredible story about this guy who's basically you know, almost superhero like, where he's taken on this persona that is, you know, incredibly investigative, and he can change disguises, and he is, you know, going deeper and deeper into investigating his father's, you know, wrongfully committed imprisonment and unfortunate death. But it is told so authentically, especially for a French show, but also, again, on that relatable level where I was like, God, even though this is French and they have all these like little quips, I'm still connected to it and I'm totally drawn into this story. And, you know, there's even all these jokes about his race in the show, but done very tastefully and in very real way. That just speaks to, you know, again, the world that we live in, and it doesn't feel fantastical or that it's taken advantage. And so I'm totally engrossed in it, because also the story is just great. And you're like, who is this guy? And just, you know, again, for an international show, I think it really, really does also almost feel like an example of what's to come in a lot of ways, in terms of taking in, you know, inclusion and taking in great storytelling, and also to be able to have it on such a platform that is exposed to millions and millions of people around the world, and to really kind of show that, yeah, that you can get it right, you know. And it's one of the few shows that I actually have seen rolled out recently that doesn't feel like it was just a show written for possibly a white character that they decided to cast black, right? It really does feel like they built this in so many ways. I mean, the last bit I'll add is like, to the point to where, you know that he and his father are from Senegal, they're Senegalese, and his father came to France to give his son a better life. And so when I say like really authentic, just in the roots of these characters' backgrounds, without it, again, feeling so, yeah, so overbloated, it's a great show. And if you like, you know, crime and a little bit of action, like it's well done.
Yeah, and you just, I saw on Instagram a quote that you posted with Stacey Abrams. It's just so brilliant. Oh, yeah. We had to put it up. You know, basically talking about being advocates for the voiceless.
Yeah, it's so great. I mean, look, Meera spoke on this earlier, but I strongly believe that, you know, media and film and entertainment, just in the content space, it's like, you know, look, we have a responsibility, because we know that the exposure there to so many young minds, like, it changes lives. It really does set the tone for how you see the world and how you see yourselves. And so when you talk about representation on screen and giving these stories a chance to just be like, to just be taken in, it means so much, right? Because it's like, no, this is how we grow. This is how we grow up on what is right and what's wrong. And it's just, I don't know, it's even more important the way I think the industry is consolidating in itself, that we make room to tell more and more of those stories, because it's just time. It's, you know, it's been 100 years plus in this industry of telling white led stories. And you're just like, guys, this is not the way the world looks anymore. So, yeah.
Meera, any favorites right now?
Oh, let's see. I mean, I'm like, kind of like watching so much stuff all the time, but I'd say like the past year, the movie that really kind of blew my mind, and like, you know, that question of like, what do you wish you had made? There's this movie called Atlantics that this Senegalese filmmaker Maddie Diop made released earlier this year. That's also on Netflix. That completely blew my mind. I mean, it's her first feature, and it's about a group of young Senegalese women, and one in particular who's in love with this boy, who then ends up on a boat migrating. I think he's migrating to Europe, and disappears, and she ends up, and it's a ghost story. Then it becomes a ghost story of how she's haunted by this lost lover. And it just moved me so much. It's just a really elegant genre movie. And that's all, that's really kind of my that's my favorite thing, is like when something can be kind of two things at once, kind of a strong character piece and also have this kind of elevated genre tone to it. But really what I loved about the story was about, I mean, I think there's plenty of tales of immigration, or not enough, but like of the migrant experience. But I think what it did that I've never seen before was a story of the people, specifically the women, that are often left behind in that story. And just the youthfulness of it. And it was just a brilliantly done film. And so that's the movie that to me has been resonating all year and that I've been telling people about left and right.
Yeah. What I love is watching a show where, for example, Rami, where, you know, a person of a differing ability is inserted in the storyline and they're just the character. It doesn't, you're not shouting out loud that, hey, look, this person has a disability. They're just a character. And that's when I love watching a show like Rami. That was one of my favorites, especially during COVID.
Rami, I mean, they knocked it out of the park.
Amazing.
It's a beautiful show.
It is. When we talk about representation, we not only mean though on screen, but we also mean behind the screens. And certainly the big names in entertainment are using their platform to call out the industry. I mean, we saw Frances McDormand in her Oscar speech in 2018, demanding gender parity and racial equality with an inclusion writer. And then Joaquin Phoenix just in 2020 when he won for Joker, and he said that in his speech, he felt conflicted about his privilege and the industry sending a clear message to people of color that you're not welcome here. It's changing, but clearly there's a lot of work to do. How much difference has that made to hear people like them calling the industry out?
I mean, what I appreciate is that it is putting the conversation on a more national, larger scale, right? Like in terms of making sure that people are aware of this issue and it's not just so insular anymore. However, I do think we have a long way to go when it comes to putting more people of color behind the scenes and putting more women. And what I speak to was less on the studio side, but more on the union side. And I think, you know, there's a big disconnect in terms of like, well, how do people get hired and what is that? What does it mean to be eligible, right? To be able to even be on the hiring list and getting through the bureaucratic red tape that has existed for that pipeline. And so when you really, really look into the granular details of that, it's infuriating because the truth is, you know, even for a show like Insecure, talking to our prop master who's a woman, you know, she was queer, wonderful. And when we hired her 2 years ago, she was so upset because she really, really wanted to find a person of color as her, not a proper assistant, but to work under her. And she came to us and was like, guys, I just like literally scoured the United States and found that there is only one black prop master in the whole entire union. I think now there's two. And she was livid. And it was so eye-opening for her to have been in the industry for as long as she hadn't done this work to realize like, okay, I want to do better. I want to make a change. And then saying like, oh, my own union doesn't even have the means to support, you know, this pool of candidates that I need. And how do we change that, right? How do you change this idea that, you know, you need, you know, so many credits or you need so many levels of experience, and who actually makes those decisions? And you know, the studios kind of call their hands up and point to, well, you know, anyone can be hired. But then when you really look at the, you know, the ways in which we're contractually obligated to hire these union jobs, that needs to change. And they need to do a better job of creating pipelines within those organizations to bring more people into the fold so that they can be hired. And that's where I get frustrated.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. I mean, there's, you know, I think that it's quite in some ways easier to have these diversity mandates for representation in front of the camera and even for directors and for writers. But like there's a real problem in terms of all the invisible labor that goes into filmmaking and the positions that Deniese is talking about. And I've definitely experienced that. I mean, you know, no matter, you know, how diverse the content that I'm shooting or how, you know, like kind of how diverse the director slate or the writer's room, that, you know, the crew is still largely male and largely white. And that, you know, creates that still impacts the environment in which you're shooting. It largely impacts the environment in which you're shooting these stories in.
Absolutely. And even narratively sometimes too, like talking about the props again, for us, you know, our show is so authentic and we really do take the time at every level of detail in pre-production and production to make sure that this world, the world of our characters feel real, right? To how it really is in real life. And so when you think about why that's important to say we want a person of color to assist with this, it's because there's that shorthand in a way. There's this cultural understanding and acknowledgement. And not to say that, you know, a white person can't go and learn about Black culture and bring that into their job. But when you, you know, are about to go into 3-4 months of production, we don't want to have to sit there and teach anybody our culture to get it right, you know, and that slows us down and it's painstakingly versus saying like, you know, it's the same when you hear about Black actors who say, I really want a hairstylist who knows how to work with my hair texture, right, and do, you know, things that make sense for who I am as a Black woman. And so even those little nuances mean the world to, again, just doing things the right way, but also the fact that you just don't have enough eligible people of color to be able to then go and hire from when you need those specifics, it's infuriating. And I think that's where the change is going to have to come from.
And what I see with both of you and the work that you're doing is, you know, obviously it takes a collective effort in the world of women to amplify and support each other. And I see that you're leading by example here by doing that. And it's just wonderful.
Hope so. I mean, I'll say also from my perspective, it's just like, you know, my job, just even stepping on a set becomes so much easier when I'm surrounded by other women. You know, like there's a substantial difference when I have like a female DP versus a male DP, though I've worked with wonderful male DPs. It's still like there's just a shared sense of being when you are like collaborating with people that have had the same experiences in life that you have that allows you to reach new levels of what you're doing. So it's just so important, yeah, to just broaden the palette of people we're seeing on all levels.
Both of you. So as you both know, this is a conference dedicated to providing actionable advice to the audience about how to create a more inclusive world. So aside from watching your amazing productions, how can audiences take your message home and integrate it into not only their daily lives, but also into their work?
I mean, I think it's just about writing your stories and finding a way to tell your stories no matter what. Again, like what, you know, what you guys have been doing with Color Creative and just what I, you know, the only way I could figure out, again, how to get into this business was just by doing it, you know, in the bootstrappiest way imaginable. So, I mean, in terms of actionable items, I think it's about that. In terms of content for content creators, in terms of the audience, I think it's about financially supporting, you know, content by filmmakers of color and women, you know, like really kind of not waiting for the movie to come onto streaming, but renting it on demand when it's released and really putting your dollars behind this content. Because money, you know, money speaks in this business. That's everything.
Yeah, totally agree. And to add to that, I'd say also when it comes to making the content, I mean, it's also not enough to just make the one, you know, and I think Meera's journey speaks so highly to that in terms of like you do the one thing, you get you exposure, but you have to keep creating your content until, you know, honestly, I don't want to say until you get to the level you want to be, but it's so important because even when I think about Awkward Black Girl, most people don't realize that was Issa's third web series. And it just happened to be the one that really spoke to the largest audience and that took her career off, but it wasn't the first thing she did. And so even in that context, you know, keep creating content, but then also find your tribe, build a network and continue to help bring in other like-minded creatives that you meet that also may not be at the level that they want to be at yet and collaborate with them with those opportunities. Because I really do believe in the power of bringing people up with you and being able to, you know, bring that amazing DP on who shot your indie film that hasn't yet made a studio film and fighting hard to get them that first studio job so they can continue to work and do more. And so, you know, build that network and really find those like-minded creatives who are just as passionate as you are, who want to create good content and create good stories together.
So what I'm hearing from you guys, just sort of the actionable items, definitely supporting financially, building your tribe, your network, and for me also reaching out, you know, reach out. Don't be afraid to say, hey, I've got something that I want to talk to you about. And you never know who might answer that phone call that could change your life. I really want to thank both of you, Meera and Deniese. Your work has led to real action and meaningful change in the industry. Nobody can do this alone, as we know. And as women of color, if you can see it, you can be it. Thank you so much for being an inspiration to all of us.
Thank you. Thank you.
You've been watching Women of Color, top producers flipping the script. This has been part of the Non-Obvious Diversity Summit, and thank you to our producing partner, SRC, and our assistant production intern, 17-year-old Meghna Parmeswaran, for helping to organize this panel. Thank you for watching. Check out all the other topics we are covering, because we have brought together voices from all genres, genders, and geographies. For more fascinating conversations like this, visit nonobviousdiversity.com. Thank you again for joining us. I'm Monika Samtani, and remember to always stay non-obvious.